Hey, did you know that if you're using chemical fertilizers for your vegetable garden, you're inadvertently causing a lot of environmental harm when there's a far more sustainable and affordable option right under your nose? And trust me, you can smell it.
Ugh, that does smell. What is that?
Ah, one of my favorite smells in the world, composted waste.
That is a smelly favorite smell. Smells like total poop to me.
That's because it is. Well, composted manure, among other things. Hey, Dirt Magicians, in this video, we are going to discuss why synthetic fertilizers are harmful to our environment, as well as how to use these wastes like manure and municipal compost to help replenish our soil and create a healthy, ecologically managed soil for our vegetable garden. As you can tell, I'm pretty passionate about the subject, and that's because in university, it was my very first research project working on analyzing the nutrient content of composted and composted manures for vegetable farms. And that is where my love of soil science and compost grew.
Brie, I've seen you be passionate about a lot of things, but poop really takes the cake. But back up for one second. Why is it bad to use synthetic fertilizers?
Great question. Synthetic fertilizers take a lot of energy to be produced. They're often mined in faraway places, which create a huge carbon footprint, and also all of the environmental degradation from the mining process itself. They're also extracting minerals, for example, rock phosphate, which we are running out of globally, except phosphorus, which is the plant nutrient that comes from rock phosphate, is so available in things like animal manures.
Ooh, that is a lot of negative impacts. So I'm gonna steer away from synthetic fertilizers, but what exactly are these naturally composted wastes and how do I use them in my garden as fertilizers?
Glad you asked. When I say composted wastes, what I'm referring to is decaying material like kitchen scraps, grass clippings, or manure that have been completely composted all the way through so they're nice and black. I like to think of it as black gold for our vegetable gardens. From a sustainability perspective, just use whatever is composted and natural to your area as a waste product. For example, where we live, we have a large forestry industry as well as fishing industry. So we have a compost called sea soil, which is the byproduct from fishing and forestry that's been composted. Because these composts are decaying plant and animal material, they contain most of the 12 to 13 nutrients that our plants need. And as they decay, the soil organisms breaking them down will release the nutrients for the plants to use. The other great thing about using these composted wastes in the garden is that they do more for our vegetable garden than just adding nutrients. They also help retain moisture in the soil so we don't have to water as frequently. They increase the soil structure so we have more tunnels for the roots, the water, and the air to flow through. And they house and feed the billions of soil microorganisms living in our soil.
Wow. Now I can see why you love compost so much. So my follow-up question for you is, can I just go to a farmer and get compost or manure, or is there anything specific that I'm looking for?
I have a few tips for purchasing a compost. The first tip, and this is definitely mostly for our composts that aren't manures, so this could be a municipal compost or like our sea soil, and we want to make sure that the compost has a minimum of 2% nitrogen on the bag. The way that we find that out is by looking for the three numbers on our bag, and that represents the nitrogen, the phosphorus, and the potassium, which are the three nutrients needed in the largest quantity by our plants. So that 2.1% on the bag is 2.1% nitrogen.
Oh, gotcha. So the 2.1 is 2% nitrogen, the 0.16 is 0.16% phosphorus, and 0.05 on the bag is 0.05% potassium, right?
That's right, nailed it, Dee. And nitrogen is needed in the largest quantity, so that's okay that it's the highest number on the bag. Now for manures, there are two main considerations. Firstly, you wanna make sure that you're purchasing a manure that has been fully composted for at least 3 months, but I would look for 6 months. And that's because the composting process heats up a lot, so it kills most of the harmful bacteria like our E. coli. If we add uncomposted manures to our vegetable gardens, we risk harming ourselves by adding E. coli into the garden. If we apply uncomposted manure into our garden, we risk harmful contamination by certain bacteria into the food that we're going to be eating.
Whoops, I didn't know there was that risk. The last thing I want from growing a healthy organic vegetable garden is to get E. coli from it.
Exactly. The other benefit to adding a composted manure is it doesn't smell nearly as bad as a fresh one.
As bad? But will it still smell?
Yes, just a little. It is poop, after all. Now, the second consideration when selecting a composted manure is that different types of animal manures have different nutrient contents in them. What we are most concerned about in terms of nutrients from our manures is, just like the compost, nitrogen, especially in the early phases of development. And that's because nitrogen is a building block of chlorophyll, which is responsible for photosynthesis. Another really important nutrient is the like button. So if you're getting value from this video, please give us some love to allow us to keep photosynthesizing too. Now, back to nitrogen. Rabbit, cow, and chicken manure typically all have enough nitrogen content for us to use in the vegetable garden. However, this also depends on how these manures were composted. If they were left out in the open uncovered, then rainfall could have leached a lot of the nitrogen out. So if you're purchasing from a farmer, make sure you ask them about how they composted their manure, just to make sure you're going to get a high quality, nutrient-rich manure. Horse manure and mushroom manure are really great for adding other nutrients. They also feed the soil organisms, they help improve soil structure, they're great for moisture retention, but they don't have a lot of nitrogen. So we can use them, but we're still gonna need to add some kind of nitrogen source as well.
Hey, you keep mentioning soil structure and soil nutrients, but I really don't know much about that.
Well, you're in luck. We designed a mini course all about the fundamentals of soil health to help empower you to create sustainable, long-lasting soil. We'll talk about what exactly soil structure is, all of the different soil nutrients and how to amend our soil for them, as well as heavy metals. And then we'll talk about management of all of those pieces too. So click the link in the description box below to take a look at our course.
Great. I find that it's really challenging to find easy to understand information about soil. Every time I look online, there's just information about the hundreds of fertilizers and amendments that I need to add to my soil. And frankly, that's really overwhelming. And since I know that you have a background both in soil science and in urban farming, I know that this mini course will be really good. Aubrey, so you said it's good to add another source of nitrogen. So in case my compost or manure doesn't have enough nitrogen, what are some other sources where I can get this from?
There are four natural ones that I'm familiar with. The first one is fish meal, and this is the byproduct from the fishing industry, and it's really high not only in nitrogen, but phosphorus, potassium, magnesium, calcium, and other trace minerals. The second one is blood meal, which is blood collected from slaughterhouses, and it's a really high source of nitrogen. The next one also comes from the sort of slaughterhouse industry, and that's feather meal. So those are the feathers, again, a great source of nitrogen. And lastly, for those that don't want animal byproducts in their soil, we have alfalfa meal, which is made from the leaves and the stalks of alfalfa and is high in nitrogen, potassium, and phosphorus. You'd only need to use one of these products. We've included links for some of our favorites in the description box below, but I encourage you to find whatever is local to your area. Also, if you have a favorite product, make sure to tell us in the comments and what region you're from so that other gardeners can learn from that. Even if you've selected a high in nitrogen, nutrient-rich compost, you might still want to consider one of those four products for some of your vegetables.
Why?
Some vegetable plants need more nitrogen and other nutrients than others. In the agricultural world, we call these heavy feeders. And the reason that they're hungrier for nutrients is because they're usually more complex structured vegetable plants. Examples of these include tomatoes, eggplant, cucumbers, squash, and broccoli.
Oh, I see. That's right. All of these plants have various structures, like the fruit on tomatoes and then the heads on broccoli. So that's what makes it much more complex.
Exactly. So because they need more resources like nitrogen and other nutrients, when I'm transplanting some of these plants, I like to add at the base one of those four sources that I mentioned. In our case here, we have blood meal, so that's what we added around the base of this tomato plant.
Yeah, that makes sense. So we've basically added now 3 inches of compost, and my compost has 2% nitrogen. So for all of my leafy green vegetables and root vegetables, this should be more than enough, correct?
Yep.
And I have blood meal here. So when I transplant the tomatoes, the peppers, zucchini, cauliflower, broccoli, and perhaps even my squash, what I'm going to do is just add that blood meal there.
Nailed it, Dee. Germagicians, if you're curious on how we built these garden beds, then check out this video on how to build an affordable, movable bed.